Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Mr. Deputy Chairman of Committees, I am pleased to be associated in adding my comments to the two documents that we placed for approval of the House today, one relating to a new set of standing orders for the conduct of business in this House, as well as the code of conduct for members of Parliament. In my opinion, this effort, which had gone through almost for the last 3 years, I have had the privilege of serving in that committee under the chairmanship of the Honourable Speaker. And I must first of all thank the Honourable Speaker for having taken his precious time to give leadership to this important effort in drafting amendments to the standing orders, which had not been attended to since 1980s. Therefore, very important groundbreaking changes have been incorporated, and I would say that particularly the concept of sectoral oversight committees, which goes to empower the backbenchers in this House to have an oversight role over the executive functions of the government, is a very, very salutary feature. But then we must understand that certain functions of the High Post Committee, as well as the other financial oversight committees, such as the Committee on Public Enterprises and Committee on Public Accounts, may also get overlapped by the provisions that we have included in the sectoral oversight committees. Since even the suitability of candidates to institutions that are appointed under each ministry can once again come under scrutiny by the sectoral oversight committee, and also the accounts and financial matters concerning the enterprises coming under different ministries could also be examined all over again by the sectoral oversight committees, in addition to the Committee on Public Enterprises and the Committee on Public Accounts. So while these overlapping oversight issues can become somewhat confusing, but I feel that continuous oversight of the executive by the legislative arm is a very welcome feature, and we must all agree that these are important changes that have been made. But then I would like to venture into another area which had somewhat been ignored and sometimes been purposely ignored by even the presiding members of this House. I beg your pardon for saying this. You know, I have in fact taken very, very strong objection to the way in which the bills are presented to the House. Quite recently we observed that the conduct of entertaining bills for approval in this House have happened in violation of constitutional provisions. Now, I speak in particular regarding, we have had in the recent past two such instances. One particularly...
Order, please.
Yes.
Speaker.
Yes, Mr.
ගරු මන්ත්‍රීතුමලගේ අවධානය යොමු කරන්න කැමති අද අපිට වැඩකටයුතු රාශියක් තියෙනවා විශේෂයෙන්ම 3ට මෙතුවන කොමිෂන් සභාවේ සභාපතිතුමාත් නීතිපතිතුමාත් ඒ වගේම පරාත් පාලන ඇමතිතුමා ඇතුළු කණ්ඩායමත් පැමිණ නිසා අපි දැන් එකගන්තයකට පැමිණියා සභානායකතුමාත් ඒ වගේම දිනේෂ් ගුණ මහත්මයාත් ඒ වගේම විශේෂයෙන්ම මේ සම්බන්ධ කමිටු සමාජික සමග අපි මේ විවාදය අද හතර වෙනකන් අරන් ගිහිල්ලා අවසන් කළා කමිටු ස්ටේජ් එක අපි ඊළඟ දවසක් ගන්න ඊළඟ සැසිවාරයේදී ඒකට සභාව එක්කද කතානේ සභාව එක්ක ඒ වගේ අතරතුර එක් අවස්ථාවක් දෙනවා සාකච්ඡාවකට හරි එහෙනම් ගරු ඇමතිතුමා
Thank you Mr. Speaker I'm glad that you have come to the chair at a time when I'm raising a very important issue Now we deal with the new standing orders and we have also made provision for the presentation of bills, and we have made a few changes. But then some of these changes don't go as far as desirable, because now I find that, Mr. Speaker, I have in particular taken objection to the way in which certain bills have been submitted to Parliament in a manner so as to deny the constitutional right of a citizen to petition the Supreme Court against such a bill. What has happened is, very surreptitiously, amendments have been introduced which is totally different to the content of the bill that have been presented. Now, we found the Provincial Council Elections Amendment Bill, which was presented in such a manner. I took very strong objections to that, both in the party leaders' meeting as well as in this House. There was a subterfuge that was used, and this type of incident must be avoided. As a matter of fact, this issue is before the Supreme Court today. And that, I think, we are all awaiting a judgment of the Supreme Court on this issue so that there will be a closure and we will not resort to such such ways in which we will deny the constitutional right. Beg your pardon? Indeed it is. Indeed it is. So therefore, it is a shame that we had now it has come to a situation after the experience we had in the last local government elections that the electoral system that we introduced is full of so many lacunas and contradictions that it has finally resulted in total instability in all. Of course, all of us are responsible for having enacted this piece of legislation. I think it is very prudent for us to now erase what we did in such a surreptitious manner, and we would revert back to the old system of elections so that we will be in a position to conduct the provincial council elections as soon as possible. But my point here is, in the presentation of bills, we have to be quite responsible. We should not simply rely on the certificate of the Attorney General to say that the bill is not inconsistent with the Constitution. But the primary right of every citizen to challenge a bill should not be denied by very surreptitiously introducing a whole new piece of legislation in place of just as amendments. And this is what happened. It was such an embarrassing situation, and we took strong objection to it. Everything was ignored and it was pushed through. And such things should never be repeated, and I hope the Supreme Court should pronounce on the objections that have been. I know the former Chief Justice went before the Supreme Court and argued this matter, since this is a matter of serious concern for legislating in this House. But in addition to that, I believe that our effort to introduce sectoral oversight committees as well as a decision to refer to the legislative committees, the bills, once bills are presented, that they must come before the sectoral oversight committees as well as to be referred to standing committees to be examined and then report to be obtained before they are passed in this House. And that's a very welcome feature. And particularly when it comes to bills which contradict which are not in consonant with the devolution chapter of the Constitution, when they are referred to the provincial councils. There again, I think some welcome features have been incorporated so that the concerns of the provincial councils could be also addressed by the relevant ministries as well as the legislative subcommittees in the House. And these are welcome features. And of course, we have also provided some new standing orders to provide for situations such as an impeachment of the Chief Justice. In keeping with the Latimer House principles, what happened in the recent past prompted all of us to include some important provisions to ensure that principles of fair play, particularly relating to due process, is afforded to any Superior Court judge who may face an issue of impeachment in the House, so that will prevent that the members of the House sitting in judgment without affording sufficient opportunity for a Superior Court judge not being able to have a fair trial. And therefore, the issue of incorporating the Latimer House principles in keeping with the Commonwealth practice in providing for a three-member panel to examine and report to the House before the House takes a decision whether to impeach or not is a very, very welcome feature. And I believe a lot of time has been taken to introduce such important amendments. Similarly, we have also introduced other features like the Prime Minister's question time, as well as the rules relating to broadcasting and telecasting of our proceedings. Of course, the issue relating to abuse of the parliamentary privileges by members, sometimes bringing out allegations in contravention of the standing orders. While we have a simultaneous broadcast or telecast, once something is said, it could not be expunged or taken away. The whatever damage before the public would have been done. So these issues need to be addressed properly. A responsible... Yes.
We have 4 more minutes.
Yes, yes, yeah. Mr. Speaker. Yeah. No, it was just a matter of concern that I thought I should be added. Now, coming back to the situation that we are now faced with currently in the country, a sense of instability has come about because of the disagreements between parties in deciding on the issue of governance in the country. But I must say that there is a mandate, and that mandate is for a national government to continue. And if the national government cannot continue, I don't think you should have a government which is unstable, which is be run by remote control by somebody else. If some parties join in supporting the government, I know that in the past, I've had this experience once in 2001, I believe, when I was removed from the cabinet all of a sudden, I crossed over to the opposition. Then there was a brief period in which there was this probationary government, the Parivasa Andua concept. A similar Parivasa Andua cannot continue in this country. So I believe certain steps are being taken, some are being spoken about, but if all parties who are supposed to be forming an administration must in the first place be prepared to take executive office. If one party is not taking executive office, and if you are going to run by proxy or by having a minority government, that is going to be the and we are violating the own mandate that we got. So those who decided to form a government, as far as Sri Lanka Muslim Congress is concerned, I must say very categorically that we would only be part of a stable government, a government which is not going to have substantial majority. It will be a total violation of the mandate that we got to serve the people. So it is a very important thing. In fact, some of our minority members who met together, we very clearly decided that we would insist on our national leaders to see that they respect the mandate that they got in forming an administration, and in that spirit, that decision should be taken without unnecessary dilatory tactics to see that the confidence that the people have reposed in our national leaders would be respected. Thank you.
Okay, thank you.